Hello there.
Listen, if you're watching this in real time, you'll be watching this episode right after you're finishing the episode 1 reaction of season 2, because I'm going to be uploading them in batches of 2. If you're watching this in the future, hello, my name is Elie Moses, a 24-year-old Lawnfield shit in Sydney, Australia, absolutely shitting his shot, and I have been watching Peaky Blinders for the very first time, and today I am up to episode 2 of season 2. I am recording this literally right after finishing episode 1. Like I said right before, I am going to plan to upload Peaky Blinders in batches of 2, so 2 episodes at a time, and I hope you guys enjoy that, so you can watch one reaction and, you know, lead right into the next. So yeah, we're gonna react to episode 2 right after episode 1. Let's get into the reaction, let's have some fun with this thing, let's absolutely smash it, let's go.
Don't reproach me.
Oh, it's Grace singing. Damn, Tommy is in all sorts at the moment after getting beat up by Sabino. And Ada, oh man, they're gonna R-word her. No, oh man, oh, it's on site after this. Oh, if you want us to hate villains, oh man. Oh, and Tom Hardy. So Tom Hardy's in this episode. So it's this one. Thank you, credits for spoiling which episode he's going to rock up in. Yes, thank you, Arthur and the boys. Thank you. Oh, and I thought that was Arthur for a second.
My name is not Sheldon.
When is she going to acknowledge that she's part of the family, man? She does not want to be attached to that name at all. Just acknowledge who you are.
Extra for daylight. Racketeering business must be booming.
Booming.
Are you not gonna thank me for saving your life? Pass me cigarettes.
Nurse!
I know it was you who carried out the murder of Mr. Duncan.
Told you, that Irish murder is not going to go out without its consequences.
Keep see. She's married now.
Oh!
To a banker. He's rich. I'm sure she's very happy. You've been under my microscope for some weeks now. I've been observing every move you make, and that is why I was on hand to save your life.
I imagine being shot by a woman hurts the same as being shot by a man. It's been more shameful. You know, Mr. Campbell, when I got shot, they gave me a medal.
I'm telling you, in another life, these guys would be best friends.
Our reunion is part of a very carefully worked out plan, which has been in place for some time now.
Every time you lean in that stick, I bet you see her face.
And as a result of the information in my possession, I can charge you with murder at any time and provide 2 impeccable crown witnesses. His testimony will lead you directly to the gallows. You are on my hook, Mr. Shelby. And from this moment forward, you belong to me.
Oh, my guy cannot catch a break.
So get well quickly. I'll be in touch the moment I hear you can piss standing up. And then I'll send you your instructions.
Shelby on a leash. I'm hoping Shelby takes this recovery time, you know, to think over things and plan his next move properly. And take as much time as you need.
Curly, you left the gate open.
No, I locked it. I pinched myself when I did it.
Get that stuff undercover. Hey, who goes there?
Oh, these guys are ready to draw arms, you can tell.
Tommy?
Curly.
Oh.
Get that oil you put on
it's
the
Tommy, my bad.
Are you fucking mad, dude?
Oh, yellow stuff, go on.
Oh, Tommy, that stuff's for rubbing into fucking horses.
I am a horse.
If you were a horse, they'd shoot you with this many broken bones.
Get the black powder, Curly. Go on. Black powder.
You pay for a bloody hospital and you're using witchcraft.
I need to sleep in the open air to feel the boat under me, Charlie.
Oh, Tommy. You're just like your mother.
Do you have a boat yet?
Only the January. She's heavy. London would take 4 days.
That'll do. Can you spare Curly? He'll be my doctor.
May God help you.
Right, back here, Curly.
And tea and whiskey. We'll have you running around like a cunt.
I'll get him aboard. I'll fill her up.
If I sleep all the way, is Camden Town ready for?
What business do you have in Camden Town, Tommy?
Tell Polly she's in charge while I'm away. But I'll come back. Tell her she's in charge for good.
I love those wide shots here of the port in Birmingham. Absolutely love it. Curly's so proud to take on this role. A pit stop in Camden Town. Oh, Tom Hardy plays Alfie Solo. Ah, let's go.
Put him down, Ollie.
What an introduction.
Put him down, mate. He's only little.
He's only little.
You on your own?
Seems so.
Well, you're a brave lad, ain't you? Well, take a look at my bakery. We bake all sorts here, mate. Yeah. Did you know we bake over 10,000 loaves a week? Can you believe it? We bake the white bread, we bake the brown bread, bake all sorts.
Is he the one that sent the letter last episode to Polly that she gave to him at the end of the episode? The one that's like, let's break bread together? Is that the, is it, did he send it?
I'd like to try some. Bread. Yeah?
All right.
But what would you like, brown or white?
Try the brown.
Brown,
what? Not bad.
Not bad, eh? It's fucking awful, that stuff.
It's fucking awful, stuff. That
so
stuff.
For the workers. Yeah. White stuff, now that is for the bosses.
That is for the bosses. Oh, he was at the London party, this guy, wasn't he?
Well, I've heard very bad things about you Birmingham people. Hey. You're gypsies, right? So would you live in a fucking tent or a caravan?
I came here to discuss business with you, Mr. Solomons.
Well, rum is for fun and fucking, in it, so. Whiskey. Now that is for business.
Let's talk first, mate. Eh?
I can tell why my friend said Tom Hardy's an iconic character.
Suit yourself.
He's great. That's already.
Like you had your life saved by a policeman. I once carried out my own personal form of stigmata on an Italian. I pushed his face up against the trench and shoved a 6-inch nail up his fucking nose and I hammered it home with a duckboard. It was fucking biblical, mate.
Fucking biblical, mate.
Come in here and sit there in my chair and tell me that I'm losing my war to a fucking wop.
That war was a long time ago. You need to be more realistic.
Realistic, yeah? Realistic.
Well, if you weren't losing the war, then you wouldn't send me the telegram.
Yeah, it was him. It was him.
You get your fucking telegram. Your telegram, you just said hello. Very simple. You want hello. To sell me something. What?
We joined forces.
Fuck off. No. Categorical. Fucking ridiculous.
Mr. Solomons,
Your distillery provides 1/10 of your income.
Listen, I said it last episode that I knew already that Tom Hardy was going to be in this show because my friends couldn't help but say it. And I was telling you guys, I'm coming clean with it. Like, that's one thing that was spoiled in the show, thing that Tom Hardy's in it. I didn't know when he was going to be introduced. But obviously, he's been introduced in episode 2 of this season as Alfie Solomons. It's great already. His character's absolutely fantastic. Just one way to improve this show. Like, listen, it was already fantastic. But to add another juggernaut actor in Tom Hardy who has a fantastic on-screen presence is just going to elevate this show to a new level. And you can tell already the way he's embracing the character of Alfie Solomons. Not just, obviously, his vocal inflections and obviously his excellent line delivery. It's just the little, like, micro-expressions he has with the character, his mannerisms, his body language. It adds so much to bringing this character to life. It's fantastic stuff. And already he has this infectious energy where I want to see Alfie Solomons on screen forever.
Protection is another 10% of the risk you make from the rice trucks. I know you keep a gun in the drawer. I know you keep it beside the whiskey. I know you offer a deal or death. What I'm saying makes you angry, but I'm offering you a solution. You see, Mr. Sabini is running all your bookies off your courses. And he's closing down the premises that take your rum. And people don't trust your protection anymore.
You're the bloke who shot Billy Kimball, right? You did. You fucking shot him. That's you.
You fucking betrayed him, mate. So it would be entirely appropriate to do what I'm thinking in my head to you right now.
Intelligence is a very valuable thing, isn't it, my friend? And usually it comes far too fucking late. They said I shot you already, right? In the fucking face. And a bullet goes bone mush bone cabinet over there. Which is a shame, isn't it? Because that cabinet's fucked now and I've got to get shot of it. What I do is this.
Not the cabinet.
It's fucking simple, mate. I cut that cabinet in half, don't I? I do. I just cut the cabinet. I cut the cabinet literally in half, mate. And I take one half of the cabinet, right, and I put it into a barrel. And I take the other half of the cabinet in all its pieces, and I put that into another barrel, right? And I send this barrel off to Mandalay, and the other barrel off to somewhere like...
Somewhere like... I know.
Timbuktu. You ever been?
No.
No? Would you like to go?
No.
You know, I always thought that you'd have a great big fucking gold ring in your nose. Oh, sorry, go on. That is your plan.
This guy's unhinged, man. Ah! Did they shake hands on it or not? Are they in league with one another? The Jews and the Peaky Blinders?
Ida.
Your living now is right in the edge of Sabini's territory, and all the coppers around there work for him. I've got a lot of money coming in, and I can't put through the banks. My accountant says the best thing is to buy property for cash and put it in the name of a family member.
But I'm not a Shelby.
A house. A whole house.
It's all yours. 4 stories, 8 bedrooms.
Damn!
Kitchen, scullery.
Well, her and Carl?
Rooms for a maid, if your political conscience will allow. Ellie's going to have a look, eh?
She gets a 4-story crib? Damn!
Mr. Sabini, the police are here.
Tell them to wipe their feet.
I never thought, listen, I said it last episode, that the guy from Charlie in the Chocolate Factory would be Mr. Sabini.
So why do I have to tell you everything?
My guy went from nothing to riches. To London.
They don't use trains, they use boats. The boatmen are old gypsies. He's a fucking gypsy. Why do we have to tell them everything?
Okay, we can't search every boat.
Lucky for me, I have a boy in the Jew's rum house.
Oh.
Gypsy went to meet Solomon's, and after, they drank whiskey, shook hands.
Oh, there we go.
And then Alfie gave him some salt or some such kike thing that means peace.
What exactly do you want us to do, Mr. Sabini?
Oh, dear. It's got the question for tutti soldati. Come here, stand on it.
This guy looks familiar too.
Okay. So you've got his fucking photo. If he shows his face in Camden Town, your coppers lift him. All right? Yeah. Sometimes when I smell something, it's something that's not real. It's something more like a premonition. It's like sometimes I smell something. But it's not a smell, it's just something isn't right.
Mr. Sabini, we'll do everything we can to deal with this man.
Deal? Did you say do a deal?
I didn't mean that.
Fuck. Fuck. Il mondo until you've been fucking god at.
No, you're being ridiculous.
Somebody's fucking sat you down. Somebody's fucking sat you down and talked to you.
Mr. Sabini.
We should go.
This fucking gypsy has sat down with the fucking coppers.
Mr. Sabini.
You fucking crazy! And you're taking with both fucking hands over me and over him!
I thought Alfie was unhinged.
Okay. So now you fucking follow Shelby. You fucking follow him and you finish him! They!
Rattled. Yeah, we're just laundering the money through property now. Her birthday present is a house.
You said you were going to buy Ada a house.
Yep, that's right, I did. Just had a bit of cash left over.
This is ours.
No, Polly. This is yours. Because you deserve it.
The boys.
What would I do with all these rooms?
Well, you could relax, for one. Come here at weekends.
There's a garden, eh? You love gardens? Can grow roses, Paul. I don't know. Have a piano. Have people around. I can have a sing song, eh?
What help the bloody neighbors?
Fuck the neighbors. Welcome home, Paul.
Told you what?
She told me what it is would make you happy.
Hey, she keeping that secret as me.
Contacts in the police. They have contacts in the council, and they have contacts with the people to keep the parish records. Records of adoptions.
Contacts with contacts with contacts.
And of confidential forced removals. Now, with your permission, I'd like to grease a few palms and take a look at the records they never showed you. I'm going to find your son and daughter, and I'm going to bring them home. That's what this house is for. So that you bring your family home where they belong.
How can you not root for this man? Like, how can you not? Listen, I know they're on the other side of the law and they do terrible things as well. But listen, we allow it.
I'm moving up, Paul.
You still just gotta think that there's moles everywhere. You know, Sabini's got his mole up in Camden Town. And listen, Inspector Campbell was talking about a person who's got a, like, they've been prepping for a mission. And I'm interested to see who that is. Maybe it is.
Can you hear that?
Maybe it is.
Silence at last.
Shelby himself.
And it belongs to us?
Yeah. Mommy, I had to chase.
What's in there?
Yo, Carl gonna have a field day in that joint. maybe it is Shelby who Inspector Campbell was prepping for their assignment, because they have that leverage on him with the Irish murder.
As long as there's more coming in, we're all right.
This came for you today. It's all the way from America, New York. Somewhere called Poughkeepsie.
I know who that is.
And the decorators doing the garrison one paying. Arthur forgot and pulled a gun when they asked, so they've stopped and everything's green.
All right, we'll just pay it. Oh, and then we need to put an advert in the mail. Garrison, grand reopening.
Oh, and you said that there's a letter I had to go today, special delivery. Wrote in the diary.
Yes. Haven't written it out yet.
That's the New York letter.
I'm gonna write it down. I've learned shorthand.
Fair enough. Dear Mr. Churchill.
Oh no, it's Churchill. Damn.
Is your pencil broken?
No. Do go on.
Like, I'm writing a letter to Mr. Churchill.
I've been approached by an agent of the Crown to carry out a task as yet unspecified.
He is the chosen one.
His name is Major Campbell, and I believe he reports to you.
Mr. Churchill, you should know that I am a former British soldier, and if you look at my war record, you will see that I fought bravely at Verdun and at the Somme. Also, you will see that my actions at Mons saved thousands of Allied lives. I know that you resigned your ministerial position and the safety of an office to go and fight on the front line with the men. I've read that you fought bravely, Mr. Churchill. Therefore, I hope I will be treated in any dealings we have with a degree of respect.
That's the leverage he has. Soldier to soldier.
My demands are slight, and my sacrifice in service of my country will no doubt once again be great. Yours sincerely, Thomas Shelby. Military Medal and the DCM. Distinguished Conduct Medal. Hands up in this room, those who were at the Somme. Those who were at the Battle of Verdun. Thomas Shelby was a tunneler. His demand is rather amusing. He has asked that the Colonial Office grant him an Empire Export License. Specifically, a license covering India, Malay Peninsula, Canada, and Russia. He plans to transport certain manufactured goods from Birmingham to the Poplar Docks.
And you plan to agree to this demand?
Dear God, Major Campbell. We will be asking this man to carry out an assassination on behalf of the Crown. Once more, risking his life. These demands, by comparison, are slight and easily met with a few quiet words over lunch.
I know, that's all you need to do. Ministers.
Sir.
What?
With the greatest respect.
What he's asking is literally, listen, what he's asking is literally nothing compared to what their assignment is for him. Now, I want to talk about, listen, I apologize if there are some scenes in this show where I'm just silent and still. And I said that in Band of Brothers, and you guys are saying, listen, we love that. We love that you include as much as the episode as possible. Your times where you don't talk, reactions in itself, you know, your times where you're just silent. We love seeing that. We love seeing you just pay attention to a scene. And I'm grateful for that. Thank you, guys. But yeah, I just want to talk about like how immersed I am in the world of this show. And I say it with Boardwalk Empire as well, because these two shows came out at similar times. I talked about a word a couple of weeks ago about Peaky Blinders, and I compared it to a show I'm watching at the moment, The Acolyte on Disney Plus. And I forgot what the word was. It starts with a V, and I'll think about it and remember it in a second. But it basically means making something feel real. I think it's verisimilitude, I think. Making something feel real. And there are points in the show where I'm watching it and I'm just like, I'm doing a reaction at points and I forget the camera's on and I should make a comment because I'm so immersed in the characters and their conversations and the world building. It's absolutely fantastic.
Thomas Shelby as a murdering, cutthroat, mongrel gangster.
All right, enough with the adjectives.
The tunnels were dug beneath our feet to silence the guns pointed at our heads.
Hey, he's done a mad service to his country.
Get Thomas Shelby's details from Campbell and get some kind of royal appointment set. Temporary.
Temporary.
Just until the deed is done. Agreed, Major Campbell.
And then I can proceed as discussed.
To take him out myself.
Agreed, sir.
Probably.
Does he know what his real name is?
His real name is Johnson. Henry Johnson. Now, I would like you to go away. I'll come back when my husband's here.
Truth is, he was taken from his mother without her permission.
Henry, go back inside, please.
So this is Aunt Polly's son.
Please, Henry, come on.
Your real name is Michael Gray.
No.
Your real mother wants to see you. Her address is on the back of this card. She just wants to talk.
Go away!
She just wants to talk.
Go away!
Damn, Arthur continuing to go in on. Arthur's going to be one of those characters where you have immense highs and then insane lows with him. And it looks like he just beat another man to death.
It's been a few times lately. 6, 7. It's like he's not there in the head. He can't even stop, even his own name. And then he cries.
Yeah, we... obviously know from season one when Arthur tried to commit suicide.
Promise to me.
He's not all there.
That's two fucking stories. Your brother killed a boy. There were witnesses. There will be questions. Get your story straight. It was an accident. Fuck off.
Doesn't need this headache.
I spoke to the doctor. He said the kid... heart. We'll look after his mother. He'll be fine.
Polly said I should have stuck with the medicine. I said that you know best. It's like a fucking bad toy. Full of heavy cargo like coal or iron.
Tragic character.
Sometimes it slips to one end. The bad tips. I can feel it slipping. And I can feel the bad tipping. But there ain't nothing I can do about it.
Sad, man. It's sad.
It's like me fucking edges is like this fucking black fucking bad. And it just fucking drifts. Eat it out, eat it out.
I was home a long time now, Arthur.
I was treating like a fucking kid again, eh? Keep you away from guns and fucking rope. Is that it? You think I haven't got enough fun?
Stop it.
Arthur, you think I haven't got enough fun?
Stop it.
The war is done. Shut the door on it.
Stop it.
Shut the door on it like I did, eh?
Like
can you do that? Yeah. Like I fucking did. Shut the fucking door, eh? I'm not fucking you! I'm not fucking you! Everyone fucking knows it! God! Look at yourself. hurt yourself.
That was such a beautiful scene right there, and I know I remained dead silent during it, but it was absolutely fantastic to just drain out any tense music or dramatical music and just let, you know, the actors themselves do the talking, let the emotions do the talking. I thought it was absolutely superb, and I was saying before, I think Arthur's going to be this tragic character where you have insane highs with him and you think you're in this honeymoon phase, but then you're going to get dragged back down to earth and realize how much of a tragic character he is. You know, he's clearly dealing with some deep psychological trauma and mental issues from what we saw in season one after attempting to take his own life. And listen, we know Tommy himself has these coping mechanisms about the war, you know, balling everything up in that room. And then obviously how Grace was able to release some of that as well. And with Arthur, listen, some people are never the same again. And, you know, there was this comment on one of my Boardwalk Empire reactions, I believe, because there's a character in Boardwalk Empire as well, who's a real tragic character dealing, you know, with the war straight after as well, and trying to associate himself and trying to, come to grips with normal life. And obviously this season is set 2 years after season one, but some people never fully recover. And there was a comment as well, one of my Pacific reactions and Band of Brothers reactions, I believe, I can't remember, one of those shows, talking about how there wasn't an emphasis on mental health, or that much of an emphasis on mental health in society post World War II, and people were expected to just, you know, embed themselves back into normal society and resume life just as normal. And if there wasn't an emphasis of it on it post World War II, what makes you think there was going to be the same? What makes you think there was going to be one in a post World War I? And that's the case, obviously, with Boardwalk Empire and this show right here. And listen, these things, people never recover from. And you saw Danny as well. You will have glimpses where you think they're going to be fine. And listen, I know Tommy is, listen, thinking about the operations of the family, and yes, in terms of like, you know, the operations of Shelby Limited, and how things are going with the family, he doesn't need Arthur's problems. He doesn't need his problems again. He doesn't need another headache. He's already becoming a pawn to Inspector Campbell and Churchill's political game, with him, you know, having to carry out a potential assassination on someone or a hit on someone. So he doesn't need the headache of a family member trying to take his own life and making rash decisions. So I understand it from Tommy's point of view, but at the same time, Arthur is an individual who probably needs medical attention and therapy, and definitely needs to be around others and cannot be alone. Hence, obviously, Tommy smashing the bottle of liquor right there and taking the bullets out from the revolver. I wouldn't have left him alone there. Obviously, as a brother, you need to be there and support your family member through these tough times. But I understand from the perspective of Tommy, obviously, he's got a lot going on. And dealing with the time period this show is set in, obviously, you know, you're expected to deal with it, ball up what happened in the war, leave it locked behind, and, you know, deep down, just send it packing. But as you know, with the character of Arthur, he's probably never going to recover from that, and it's going to be this tragic story where, like I said, we're going to have highs, we're going to have lows, but I think we're going to, you know, the lows themselves and those tragic moments are gonna, listen, outweigh the highs we're gonna have with him. Because we saw last episode how much they enjoyed that holiday in London. You know, they were ecstatic to go there. Even John, who had his worries because of Esme and himself about the expansion, you saw, listen, they laid the law in that town. Listen, they rolled up in the Peaky Blinders as gangsters, badass, looking for a fight. And obviously, they laid their claim, or they made a stamp. And yeah, that was a high. You saw Arthur, he was brimming with confidence. But then this episode, listen, it's he's going to have his peaks and troughs. But the troughs themselves, listen, they're going to sink to new lows.
Time for lunch there. I thought we could eat at the desk at the old days.
This guy on Tommy Shelby's payroll. And back with Inspector Campbell now.
You're remembered.
Talking pickle, sir.
But it's the single stroke of mustard that's a thing. The fine detail. Speaking of detail.
Here we go.
How much is Thomas Shelby paying you in bribes per week?
He stopped chewing.
Actually, I already know. £2 a week, £8 a month.
How does
extras for specific favors?
How does he know?
When I left, you were an honest man.
This guy's got spies in the city everywhere.
Peaky Blinders payroll.
Listen, he wasn't gonna return to Birmingham without having his sources planted in.
He gets in through your ear with a whisper. He crawls in over your tongue as you lie to the judge and the pastor. Mr. Moss, we are entering a bloody phase of a bloody war with no quarter asked or given. But as of this moment, you are now back on the side of the angels. Shelby thinks you work for him, but in truth, you work for me. And I will use you mercilessly.
A lot of people becoming pawns in this show. To a larger game.
Polly, these are the files for Michael and Anna Gray. As you can see, one is white. And one is black. What you saw in your dreams was right.
Anna passed away.
Your daughter is dead. After Anna was taken from you, she was put with a family of a railway station master in Stafford. She never settled, so she kept running away. Got on a train to Birmingham once. Eventually, they sent her to Australia.
Hey!
Where she died of something called spring fever.
The whole big world out there. He's still trying to look.
My little Anna.
Yeah, she's trying to still trying to look for Australia.
Traveled all the way back across the world to be with me in my dreams. She came all by herself. Well, one train they couldn't get her off.
I've seen him.
I know where he lives. I went there. But Paul.
And?
Okay, Polly, listen to me. Just listen to me, please. Paul. The woman that he calls Mother will never let him come in.
Just tell me where he is, Tommy.
Polly, if you go there, you
gets mad and she calls the police, they will never let you anywhere near him, and the boy will get scared. That's what'll happen, Paul. Polly.
You just tell me where he is, Thomas.
Damn! It means,
tell me where he is, Thomas.
It means that much. She needs to keep her composure over there. And he knows she won't.
Pulling the gun is why I can't tell you.
She's gonna make a scene with that woman.
Paul, I'm sorry. You're gonna have to wait till he's 18. Till he's old enough to make his own decision.
He's gotta understand that. It's a hard decision. Oh no, she ain't.
You tell me where he is!
Shoot me, you'll never know.
Wait it out, man. Please. Now we're gonna have to fix the ceiling. Really? She has to understand that. She has. It could get ugly if she goes there. He's right. Like, he's right. At least the garrison's opened back up. That's one positive to take from this episode. And the deal with Alfie Solomons. But we know now there's a mole that Sabino has in Camden. So, in the bakery. Ben and his boys going to the garrison. I need to find myself a Peaky Blinders outfit, man, for these reactions. That'll be insane. I had the cap. I'm still trying to find it. I've been looking. I can't. I had a gray one, too.
It's good to the father. It'll help you.
Now, if you thought he was already stuffed up, it's about to get a lot worse. With the cocaine. Yep, there we go. Even with the camera shots. Oh, the buzz is real. The buzz is real. I just know, like I said, you're gonna think you're gonna have these insane highs. And like I said, the troughs are gonna be all the much worse.
You've seen the dough tours after a race.
Oh yeah.
Grand openings of race days only, brother.
Yeah, I don't know if he's gonna stay true to that. I'm guessing Tommy gave Finn the Tokyo, or instructed him to give the Tokyo to Arthur. Again, last episode we had that beautiful one-take shot within the booking level at Shelby headquarters, and then yet again we had one of those one-takes through the garrison. It's good to see the pastor as well at the garrison. I forgot his name. Is it Julian or Julius? I can't remember. Oh yeah, we haven't opened the letter yet. True. No! Let the past be the past. Burn it away. You don't want anything to do with it. You don't want any reminder. Safe to say that possibly he's been doing that to all of her letters. And it's a struggle each time.
Ada, I didn't know you were coming.
Yo, is Aunt Polly on the Tokyo as well?
Oh, Ada, why don't you think about coming home?
Hello, Ada.
Sid.
She's not talking to Tommy at the moment.
What do you think, eh?
It's very,
Gold?
Yeah.
Hey, new set. Let the production design team, you know, spice up the garrison a bit. That's why we did the bombing at the beginning of season two, sorry.
So what do you want me to say to her?
Just talk to her. No one can get through to her. Tell her I've no choice. Appreciate this.
Hello, brother.
I'm telling you, she on the Tokyo, man.
Why don't you come and join us?
The Tokyo and the drinks.
Don't want conversation. I want an address. Till I have that. I've got anything to say. Now it's a party. Yeah.
She's gonna be mute the whole time until she get that address. You gonna blackmail his ass?
And I'm gonna enjoy myself.
No, Paul, don't be silly.
Excuse me. Would you care to dance?
It'd be my pleasure.
My love, pleasure hasn't even begun.
Damn. We're about to have baby number 3 on the way. That's even possible. It might be possible. Ah, Paul, damn! I told you, she on the Tokyo, I'm telling you. That's not just the drinks talking. Damn, she having a wild night. Tommy had a threesome? Damn! That was a grand opening, or reopening for the garrison. Oh, she gonna do something stupid. That hangover hidden.
Excuse me. I'm looking for someone called Elizabeth Gray.
Oh, that's Michael.
I saw she lived here at number 17.
That's Michael.
I came last night, but there was nobody here.
Oh yeah, your mother was having the time of her life.
What do you want with Elizabeth Gray?
I think she might be my mother.
See? All good things come to those who wait. He said wait. He just came to you. Yo, wait till he meets the boys. Like, and I mean all the boys. My guy looks like he belongs in Narnia right now, but wait. So he's truly welcomed in the family, if he really is. Ah, crazy ending. There we go, the first 2-episode stint, ladies and gentlemen, of Peaky Blinders, and it was the first 2 episodes of season 2. Listen, 2 great episodes. I feel like we're not going to have a bad episode in this series. Listen, I've heard things about some of the later seasons, like not what happens in them, but one of my friends just told me, oh, they rushed season 6. He goes, I don't like season 6. And he said another season, I think it was 3 or 4. He goes, I didn't like those seasons too. I'm like, oh, listen, I'm going to make my own judgment. I'm going to watch the show for myself. Then I have my other friends telling me, no, it's 6 seasons of fantastic television. So it is what it is. I guess we'll find out as we chug along with this show. Listen, 2 great episodes to start season 2. Listen, we're planting those seeds. We're planting the breadcrumbs for what is to come, and more problems are going to come with Inspector Campbell and Churchill plotting their scheme, you know, and a lot of individuals becoming pawns in this game. And, you know, Tommy Selby, he ain't going to be a pawn. No way he's going to settle with that. He going to do that one off for Inspector Campbell and Churchill. And we'll see what happens after that. Listen, they still haven't sort of initiated their grand plan with him. They're sort of, I think, setting everything in motion thus far. I don't think they have hinted at who they want him to take out at the moment. So it's going to be interesting to see what Churchill and Major Campbell are planning. And at the same time, as Shelby's trying to handle that business, he's got the business with Sabino and the Solomons to handle, because they're at war. They've been at war for 6 months, and he's just provided additional men to Solomons. But at the same time, Sabino is aware of that because of the mole he has at the Solomons. So yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how it all plays out, ladies and gentlemen. And then obviously you got the family drama entangled with everything. It's absolute madness at the moment. So yeah, I hope you guys enjoy my reactions. As always, it's been your boy Moses. Take care. God bless. Peace.